The social order of the new age is a theocracy. Its head is the Brotherhood of Shambhala. The Mahatmas make sure that the will of God is carried out on earth. Just as in the Middle Ages, Jesus was appointed spiritual leader of the order of the Temple Knights, or was regarded as the head of the ideal state. True justice only prevails in that state, the founder and ruler of which is Jesus Christ. All people and all institutions are working in the spirit of the great souls who are responsible for this planet. Everywhere is exhibited their picture. Everywhere they preside, at least in spirit. Everywhere we ask, how would they act? What advice would they give? All power is entrusted from above and exercised in the name of the Mahatmas. For its use, one is held accountable. People will recognize that they fare best when they submit to the leadership of the Mahatmas, both as individual and as a community. The new teaching of Agni Yoga must imbue all areas of life, both the private, e.g. marriage and family, as well as the public sector, politics, business, society. The separation of church and state is necessary, but there can be no separation between faith and governance. A faith such as Christianity, as it is taught today, which can no longer give a politician or an entrepreneur any guidance for his actions, is worthless. A hierarchy only rarely reverts to elections. The bearers of greater responsibility are selected from the outset only from a small, long educated, tried and tested circle. From a circle to which everyone has access, in which, however, he can rise to higher positions solely on account of his character, his proven selflessness, and his often tested fulfillment of duties. Such a community of hierarchs fills vacant positions only in exceptional cases through internal election, but not by popular vote. Imagine a village, a kindergarten or a school, a law firm or a business. The few hierarchs that lead such an institution have long been familiar with each other's strengths and weaknesses. Therefore, they can judge fairly well who is best suited for what office. In general, a certain candidate will recommend himself without formal procedure on the basis of his character and talent. Only when, in exceptional cases, several persons equally suitable and equally willing to serve are available, an election might be considered. The leaders of the future will be selected not by the irresponsible masses, but verily by the hierarchy of light and knowledge. This is a most unusual picture for us today. We must remember, however, that a selflessly serving spiritual leader will never press for office. When their turn comes, they should take over the toils of politics and become rulers for the public good, not as though they were performing some heroic action, but simply as a matter of duty. He does not seek anything for himself. He has no ambition or thirst for power. He only notes the burden of responsibility. Only those who think this way are apt to be true leaders. We accept leadership not as a distinction, but as an immutable necessity. Such responsibility should be the foundation of all human communities. One fitted for true leadership is generally backward about asserting himself. Unless a definite call has been made upon him by others, he will avoid everything which tends to push him to the front. His knowledge of his own limitations is so keen that it is actually painful if he be placed in a situation where he appears to stand forth as a superior in the eyes of his fellow men. Childish struggles for power, as between present-day politicians, cannot come up among hierarchs. In other states, men fight one another about shadows only and are distracted in the struggle for power, which in their eyes is a great good. Whereas the truth is that the state in which the rulers are most reluctant to govern is always the best and most quietly governed, and the state in which they are most eager, the worst. Spiritual leaders serve in common the high goal of the realization of the divine will on earth. They recognize without envy the greater capacity of a co-brother. They are actually glad to be able to serve under a greater spirit, because that diminishes their load a little bit. They know that exercising power is a sacrifice. The higher the position, the more. They do not push themselves into the foreground. On the contrary, they take over the burden only when they are called upon to do so. Contending for precedence cannot exist in brotherhood. A natural hierarchy flows out of priority of knowledge and preeminence of spirit. Where it is realized that precedence is a great sacrifice, there can be no wrangling about earthly denominations. Power, blessed by the highest knowledge, and strained by the heart, is the highest sacrifice. This concept reveals a wonderful picture to us. In order to make this vision a reality in the course of the next centuries, we must, by strict training and education, breed such a class of sages, initiates, and hierarchs. We need rulers who are pure, wise, strong, and selfless enough in order to recognize the higher will, to let themselves be guided by it, to convey it to humanity, and to enforce it on Earth. Most important, a hierarchy is not built upon coercion, neither physical nor psychological. It is based upon the trust of the so-called ordinary people that they fare best in an order in which truth and justice, and not the right of the stronger, prevail. A hierarchy is built upon the conviction of the people that the Mahatmas of the Brotherhood and their representatives are best suited to maintain such a kind of an order. Indispensable is a certain quality on the part of the people themselves, trust in and recognition of the power. Therefore, in different matters, I so often reiterate about authority. The hierarchy does not impose itself on anyone. On the contrary, it takes over only when summoned, and it withdraws immediately when it should lose the necessary confidence. We cannot replace the old by a new form of government from one day to the other. Life is so complex, it is impossible to bring to Earth immediately all the conditions of the higher worlds. Our Earth and its population are not yet ready to accept higher laws and higher conditions. Therefore, one is obliged to tolerate the present customs and circumstances, striving at the same time to improve and ennoble them as much as possible. A gradual transition could begin by recognizing how important for ruling a people are submission to the cosmic laws and personal qualities such as purity and wisdom. We are not shaking the foundations, but are trying to establish a proper worldview. In this knowledge, ethics councils, formed of spiritually high-standing members of the community, might be attached to the authorities in all institutions, on all levels. For a long time, it has become clear that neither professional specialists nor politicians are qualified to decide in matters of ethics. Not the masses, not the majority, but only the sages can hope to find the right answer to the question of what is permitted to man and what is not. There dawns the realization that mankind hurts itself when it does what is forbidden. We urgently need wise teachers who, like Islamic religious savants, can deliver a profound judgment, fatwa, on the ethical issues facing the individual and the society. However, real sages must be appointed, and not, as in today's ethics councils, representatives of party interests who decide by majority. Can there be any judgment concerning peace among those who are full of coarseness and cruelty? No one is concerned with the moral level of those who sit in judgment on the destinies of whole nations. No one will reflect that nothing clean comes out of dirt. At the beginning, the ethics councils would not even have to exercise any power. They should have such a strong position because of the moral authority of their members that the politicians could only with difficulty overrule their opinion. The ethics councils would be the institutionalized conscience of the rulers. At all times, spiritual leaders such as Plato or Gandhi have directed the destinies of whole nations without any external means of power. A model can in some respect be Islam. Here, for example, special control bodies in companies make sure that business or banking transactions are carried out according to the rules of faith, and that unethical projects are abstained from. The so-called Islamic banking